Okay, are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
All right, what's your name?
Mason Foster.
And why are you important?
Because I found something. In the summer of 2016, I went down to La Misión, Mexico to volunteer at Open Arms Daycare for a week.
My name is Heidi Elizarreras. I'm the founder and director of Open Arms Childcare Ministries down here in Baja California, Mexico. Open Arms is a no-cost childcare for needy families. Our goal is to keep kids off the streets and out of orphanages, kids that don't need to be at an orphanage, that are just there for poverty reasons, and kids that are being locked in their home so their mom or dad can go to work. You know, there's not a big childcare system in Mexico. It's almost non-existent. And we really believe that God has ordained the family and we're called to keep families together. We're called to fight for the families. And so we've built a daycare facility. It's really a home away from home for a lot of our kids here. It's a refuge where they can come every day, knowing that they're safe from the harm of the streets, of things that can happen to them being locked in their homes. They're not being dropped off at an orphanage because they're able to go home with their family every single day. And they're able to receive the love of Christ here.
I never understood why people were religious in places like La Misión. They just don't really have a reason to believe in God. I know that a couple years ago when I went down, I was talking to one of the workers and she was telling me that sometimes when they give the kids like lunch and breakfast, they don't want to eat it. And it's not because they're not hungry, but it's just because they've been hungry for so long that it hurts their stomachs to be so full. So I think if anyone has the right to discredit God or to be angry with God, it's them.
Coke is like the national beverage of Mexico. Like, it's crazy. So.
Okay.
We came when there was a flood one year. And the riverbed had flooded, and they had been living in like cardboard and wood houses next to the river. So when the river came through, the mud just filled up their whole house. Like, they barely escaped. At the time, she had 5 kids, and they literally swam out of their house with the kids on their back and only the clothes that they had on. And so we packed up everything we had and everything we could find, and we came down, and we just kind of went out like on a search and rescue type trip. God used a horrible situation to bring them to a place where, like, she could get help. The kids have grown, and now they're going into junior high this next year, and she's had 2 more babies, and, you know, she has her own field now that is, you know, something that I'll never forget. It's something that impacted me personally, and it still impacts me to this day.
Hola, Carlitos. Martín. ¿Hablar y así?
No.
¡No, Carlitos!
Yeah.
arriba.
What about Osbaldo?
Osbaldo.
Osbaldo.
At first, he was just this shy kid that was always around my camera. But as the week progressed, he was the one that I got the closest to. So I'd let him use my phone and take whatever shots he wanted, but they ended up being better than mine. After that, I just started to watch him and learn from him.
Osbaldo
is... I was doing interviews, and in between one, Heidi told me about Osbaldo, which is like one of the kids in my group. And how she basically like told me that that he was gonna come home and see his dad for the first time in a couple weeks, and his dad had been going through chemo and was all that the three brothers, Osbaldo being the youngest, Roberto and Jesus, had, and that their mom had abandoned them, you know, years ago, and their grandmother had passed away already, something like that. So they really had nobody else. And their dad has like a 20% chance of living.
Osbaldo was one of the sweetest and the shyest and the most compassionate kids in my class. And I felt like there was nothing I could have done for him. When I would hear people say, you know, we're going to rely on God or we're going to pray about it, I was just frustrated because I felt like God wasn't doing anything for him.
He's going to ask you me and then... Her name was Lupita. She was only like an... At that time, she was like an 8-year-old girl. Her dad was an abusive parent towards her mom and her, and her mom ended up leaving. Her dad would like lock her in a dark room, no light, just kind of treat her like an animal, like an animal in a cage. He didn't really feed her. She would go to the bathroom and eat her own feces, and that's something that kind of like impacted, and it's kind of heartbreaking to hear that someone could be so cruel to do that to their own kid. How much of an impact it would have been on her emotionally. To be treated like that and to not feel loved and not feel protected by her parents. Open Arms came in, and that's where they always come to the rescue, which is awesome. But they gave her, they literally opened their arms to her and accepted her into the daycare.
How do you deal with the fact that God has allowed this to happen to someone so innocent?
Good question. I think, I don't know. Let me just throw that out there. But I do think it's such like a rough spot to think about. But I just strongly believe that God does have a plan for our lives and for whatever we go through, and it sucks, and I don't know why, and I don't know why she went through that.
So when I started to ask these questions of like, why does this have to happen in the first place? Like, why are there these tragedies? I was told that it was so that we could choose to love God. And that just was not a good enough answer, because if God was allowing Osbaldo to get hurt in this way so that he could be loved, then that's not a good God. That's not a God who saves. That's a selfish one. Taking a bunch of kids to the beach doesn't solve anything. Seeing Osbaldo in the water and as joyful as he was, like, I've never seen a kid look like that. I don't know, it was just the most beautiful thing that I've ever seen.
So Emilio just took Hannah's phone. And the first thing he did was open Pokemon Go.
A monthly sponsor. For as little as $25 a month, you can truly change a child's life. And we're completely dependent on individuals and churches that support us on a monthly basis. And the best scenario is consistency, that you're consistent in your monthly giving. You know, you can have a personal relationship with these kids. It's not someone, a poor child on a TV screen that you'll never know where your money's going, you'll never get to meet that child. You can personally come down, eat lunch with your child, hug them, play with them on the playground, tell them that Jesus loves you. You can write them letters, send them a birthday and a Christmas gift, and just be consistent. come back with your mission team every single year and bless these children.
Open.
Osbaldo and his brother's ability to love people and to be joyful and to just believe in anything, despite how terrible their circumstances were, for me makes them heroes because it requires so much courage and sacrifice of time and of energy and even of comfort to be able to hope like that. So, I don't know, I guess it changes things.
Why?
Because then it's not really a selfish God. Like, if the work of God is to make us heroes, if it's to give us these traits like resilience or perseverance, like things that require hardship, then it's not so much that it's a selfish God. It's more like a God that's still in the process of creating us and allowing us to decide if we want to be heroes or not. Even if I walk away from you, even if I walk away from you,
even if I walk away from you. Okay, are you ready? Follow it. What's your name?
Mason Foster.
And why are you important?
Because I found
some.
The work of God.